Welcome, welcome. He is alive. Amen. He is alive. He is no longer in the tomb. He is risen just as he said. He is alive. Sins are forgiven. Sins are forgiven. Redemption has come to the earth in the form of the Son of the Living God, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. You know, I love what John says in the book of Revelation, that he heard a voice like a lion. And in fact, one of the angels says, "Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah." And John turns and says, "Oh, there's the Lamb, as if he'd been slain." You see, the angel saw Jesus as a lion from the tribe of Judah, the victorious lion, where John saw him as the Lamb who had been slain. He is the Lion, and he is the Lamb. He is coming back as the Lion. He may have left this earth as the slain Lamb, but he is returning as the Lion. Amen, amen, amen. I just want to declare that every day. Every day should be Resurrection Day, not just one day a year, but every day should be Resurrection Day, because God finished the work through Jesus Christ. It is finished. And I have a message today that links right in to what we just celebrated on Resurrection Sunday. You see, we look at the forgiveness of sins that for which his blood was poured out as so amazing and so powerful, and it is. But the blood goes even further than just our sin. And I think really as a whole, most of us can grasp that fact, that through the blood, our sins are forgiven. Through the blood, our sins have been atoned for. We can, in our finite minds, almost really grasp that truth. But what I'm going to teach today is something that I think many, many, many struggle with. Now, let me tell you the genesis of this. I was flipping through the TV channels last week. I mean flipping. Honk, honk. I wasn't really landing on much of anything. It was sort of a boring evening, and I just couldn't find anything I wanted. And I clicked on a channel. You have to understand that I keep closed captioning on my TV all the time, because a lot of times I'm praying with, not praying, but I'm talking to somebody on the phone, or a call comes in. And so I mute it a lot, but I just got in the habit of keeping the closed captioning on my TV all the time. Sometimes I just like to have a small sound in the house and nothing loud, and so I really can't hear it very well. Anyway, I was flipping through, and I stopped on the channel because my phone went off, and I went to look at it, and it was a text that had come in, and I looked back up, and I saw across the screen the words, and two of the words were these words, mens rea, M-E-N-S-R-E-A, mens rea. And I just didn't think any more about it and clicked on, went on with my evening. But God did not let me let go of those two words, mens rea. It was a legal show, one of those legal shows. So I Googled mens rea. And when I Googled it, it lit my spirit up inside, because God was continuing the resurrection message, the atoning message of the blood in mens rea. Now, most crimes require attorneys to refer to something called mens rea, which is simply a Latin phrase for these two words, guilty mind. Someone has to possess a guilty mind in the law for certain convictions. Here's how it was explained to me on one of the sites I looked into, that if you drove a car and accidentally hit a pedestrian, You did not demonstrate mens rea, which is a guilty mind. But if you drove purposefully into that person, that pedestrian, you had a guilty mind and therefore could be adjudicated or judged differently from an accident to an on purpose. And that is mens rea. It is a legal term, but God spoke to my heart that many of us in the church are suffering from mens rea, a guilty mind, a conscience that is guilty, a shame, a guilt, an oppression, a stronghold that we cannot let go of things in our past, that we cannot stop thinking about sins we committed or something we have done. It keeps coming up and coming up and coming up. And we feel like we have this guilty mind. Oh, we know that Jesus died for our sin. But did you know that he also died for your mind, for your memories, for the forgiveness of your thoughts? To have a sensitive conscience is a good thing. We want to have a conscience that is sensitive and functioning and doing its job. We want to have a conscience that helps us to know what's right and wrong. I believe the Holy Spirit works through that conscience that we've been given. You know, we have an idea, a sense of morality and ethics, right? And so we want to have a clean, a good conscience. Do you know that the Bible speaks to that? Let me show you these verses, and I hope this really speaks to someone who has been suffering from guilt and shame from the past. This is Hebrews chapter 9, verses 13 and 14. Hebrews chapter 9, 13 and 14. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean, sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our conscience from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God? How much more the blood of Christ will cleanse our consciences from acts. That word cleanse, means to purge or purify in the Greek. It's not just cleanse like a wiping off or a washing away. A total purge, a total just get it out and to purify your conscience. You see, if the blood of the bulls and goats in the Old Testament sanctified the Israelites for the purification of the body, just think how much more the blood of Christ cleanses us today. You see, the Israelites only experienced a momentary cleansing, just for the moment, and it was only for the outside of the body. That's what it was for, the outside of the body. But Jesus' blood works from the inside out. It purifies the heart of man, eliminating the effects of sin, eliminating the effects of sin on your mind and purging your conscience of the guilt and shame that results from sin. Can anybody just say hallelujah? Hallelujah. In Hebrews 10:1, we're not going to put it up on the screen. I just want you to hear this. We read that the law is only a shadow of good things that are coming. They weren't realities themselves. For this reason, it can never be by the same sacrifice repeated year after year. It cannot do anything, meaning it cleanses the conscience of those who want to draw near to worship. In other words, what it says is the law is only the shadow. The sense of the bulls and the blood of the bulls and the blood of the goats can only purge for momentarily alleviating the conscience, the guilt and the shame. but it would come right back. The blood of Christ wants to do more than just atone for your sin. You see, the Israelites, their bodies might be clean, but not their conscience. You see, they will not be able to forget their sin. Oh, can you imagine a place in your relationship with God where He will pour the blood, sprinkle the blood, so that you can forget what you've done? Now, not forgetting in the sense that we never, that it keeps us from not doing it again, right? But forgetting the guilt and shame of it. We'll always have the thought of it in us because that's how our human minds work. But I don't have to live with the guilt and the shame in my life. I don't. The writer of Hebrews continues in chapter 10. It says, if it could, if the blood of bulls and goats, why would they stop being offered? For the worshipers would be cleansed once and for all, but they had to repeat it every year, over and over and over. They would have no longer felt guilty if it all worked just one time and boom, it was gone. But you see, those sacrifices were an annual reminder of their sins because it is impossible. 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 That's what it says. It's impossible for the blood of goats and bulls to cleanse. See, that's the important word here, impossible. It's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin, let alone cleanse the conscience. It's God who must deliver us. We receive the Spirit as an inward experience. Everything is now inward, including the cleansing. Sin still dwells in our flesh because we are made from Adam. We created from the first man who fell, and we have a sin nature. We have the temptations. We still have that, but it does not have the power to rule us. Sin no longer has to rule us, and neither does the shame and guilt of our minds. There is no need for at least any shadow of separation between God and us. See, I think a lot of people are separated from God because they are constantly reminded by the enemy of their past sins. I know my past creeps up on me every once in a while, and it grieves me. And sometimes I know in ministry, I've had to deal and counsel with people who just can't seem to get past their own mistakes. It just keeps on coming up in their minds. They turn it over and over and over in their minds. They have not experienced the power of full redemption from the cross and the blood. You see, the conscience of that is cleansed by the blood bears witness to nothing less than a complete redemption, the fullness of God's good pleasure. You see, redemption is not just from my sin. I'm redeemed from the penalty of my sin. I'm redeemed from the power of sin. I'm redeemed by the past of my sin. I am cleansed of it all. Let me show you. This is Paul. He wrote to Titus, and here's what he wrote. This is Titus chapter 1, verse 15. Titus 1, 15. To the pure, that's us, all things are pure. But to the defiled minds and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But their minds and their consciences are defiled. But see, God wants us to have all things pure. To the pure, that's us. We've been made pure by the blood. All things are pure, including our past, including those memories. Listen, this is what Paul says in Acts chapter 23, 31. Acts 23, 31. He says this, and looking intently at the council, Paul said, Paul said, "Brothers, I have lived my life before God in all good conscience up to this day." How could Paul possibly say such a thing? He was there for the stoning of Stephen. He murdered and slaughtered Christians. He was zealous for the law, and he hated anything that had to do with the way of Christ. And yet Paul stands before the council and says, I have a clean conscience. I have a clean conscience. Now, could Paul ever forget that he was there for the stoning of Stephen? No. I don't believe he forgot that, because it was something that was, you know, part of his makeup. But he didn't suffer the guilt and shame of what he had done. You see, that's what the blood of Jesus does. It just doesn't cleanse your sin. It cleanses you from the guilt and the shame. How could Paul possibly say that? In Romans 9, chapter 1, he wrote, "I speak the truth in Christ. I speak the truth in Christ." And he further emphasizes the veracity of the statement by saying, "I'm not lying. I am not lying." And then he says, "My conscience confirms it," or bears witness in the Holy Spirit. His conscience bore witness to the fact that it was a clear conscience. How in the world? How in the world could Paul possibly declare such a thing but through the blood of Jesus applied? You remember what Hebrews says? How much more will the blood of Christ cleanse our consciences? That's the only way Paul. I love Paul. Forget what lies behind and look to the forward, to the prize that's before him. Paul forgot what lied behind him. He forgot what was back there. And he pressed forward onto the prize. How can you do that? That's what God is wanting us to understand. Stop letting the enemy mess with your minds. Stop letting the enemy speak lies into your conscience and say, "You're not forgiven. You'll never be forgiven. You'll never, ever let go of this past thing." Be Paul. "I stand before you," he says, "I have lived my life before God in good conscience up to this day." And this is the end of Acts. This is not early in Acts. This is the end of Acts, right? Oh my. There are many of us out here who are suffering from the guilt and shame of our past. But whenever authentic regeneration occurs, there will be a serious repentance, right? We have to repent. We have to repent. And when your conscience is functioning correctly, you will begin to understand from God's point of view what forgiveness is all about. Here, this is another letter from Paul. I'm giving you as much Paul as I can. We did Hebrews chapter 9. We did Titus. We did Acts. Here is 1 Timothy 3:9. 1 Timothy 3:9. Here's what Paul says to Timothy. They must hold the mystery of faith with a clear conscience. In other words, I believe what Paul is saying to Timothy, if we want to hold on to the mystery of faith, the power, the miracle of faith, we need to do it with a conscience that's been cleansed by the blood. We have to come to God with a clear conscience, not anything that we do. We have to allow God to cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death, in order to really hold on to the mystery of what faith truly is. There's a power in that faith. Oh my. Let me do Paul again. Hebrews 10. I believe Paul wrote Hebrews. So this is Hebrews 10, verses 19 to 23. Get a hold of these. This is Hebrews 10, 19 through 23. Therefore, I love that word in Scripture. What's the therefore? Therefore, brothers, Since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, remember that, by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is, his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near, here it comes, with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Because we have confidence into the most holy place through the blood of Jesus Christ, because we've had our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. No mens rea here. And if the conscience is cleansed, our heart is cleansed, of which the conscience really is the center of our heart. We read that a clean heart and a clean conscience are attainable. God wants to do it all. He just doesn't want to cleanse you from the sin. He wants your mind to be cleansed from a guilty conscience, from the guilt and shame. Let me give you one more. This is back to 1 Timothy. This is 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. 1 Timothy 1, 5. The aim, this is Paul, the aim of our charge is love that issues from a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. Did you catch it? Paul says the aim of our charge to really begin to understand love, the love of God, the love from God, the love we lavish upon God and upon others. The aim of our charge is love that comes from, here's what the pureness of love comes from, a pure heart, a good conscience, and a sincere faith. Now remember, Paul said, I want to understand faith because I have a clear conscience. Remember, that's what he said back in 1 Timothy chapter 3. They must hold the mystery of faith with a clear conscience. And then he says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, the aim of our charge, love. Everything about God comes from a pure heart, a good conscience, and a sincere faith. Oh, saints of God, will you give God an opportunity to wash your mind, to wash away the guilt and shame of your past? It is not remembered anymore by God. You are the only one who remembers it. God does not remember it. Now, we know that God does not really simply forget it, but he said they go into the sea of forgetfulness, that he hides your sin behind his back, that as far as the east is from the west, so God separates you from your sin. Saint, why are you not separated from your sin and by what you've done in your past? Mens rea, guilty mind. Like Paul, he didn't have a guilty mind. And like Paul, I don't have a guilty mind. Oh, Satan will want to remind me of my past sins. He will want to remind me of things that I have done that I am so grieved by. But I don't have a guilty conscience because the blood of Christ cleanses me from within. Here's what I wrote. Are you restless? Are you ashamed? Are you fearful? Are you torn within? Are you distressed? Are you depressed? Are you guilty and full of shame? Only the blood of Christ can make your conscience clean so that you can come to God and have beautiful fellowship with him and serve him. Only the blood of Jesus. Here's my final, this is how I wrote it for me, for Jenny Pfister. I'm going to use the first person. Only the blood of Jesus can cleanse my stained conscience, from sin and guilt. There is no other way. When I trust in Jesus Christ, all my guilt is taken away, past, present, and future. That's what justification is, really. It's wonderful. Because justification is another legal term in Scripture, just like mens rea is Latin for guilty mind. Justification means just as if I had never sinned. You see, in our legal system, we have guilty and not guilty. That's not the same legal system of God. In God, you have guilty and innocent. Guilty and innocent. Not guilty. Innocent. And his blood, see, that's justification, makes us innocent before the judge. There's no not guilty. There's just complete innocence. And God wants that for you to know that you have been adjudicated completely innocent through the blood of the Lamb. That's what Resurrection Sunday is all about. Will you let him resurrect your good conscience, your clear conscience, from the guilt and shame that the enemy would want to put on you? It's powerful. It's wonderful. It's liberty. It's freedom. And it's free for you and me. All we have to do is ask the Lamb that was slain, Jesus Christ, to sprinkle our hearts and give us that clean conscience. If you don't know him, you need to find someone who can lead you to him. Let us do it. Oh, he loves you so much. And he's painting a picture of your life with his, one brushstroke at a time. God bless you.